Okay, so thank you, Jeremy, for teeing us up here. So the talk's going to be talk about what Qualcomm does for RAM dump collection. We've had some interest to talk about what we do. We'd like to get some of this, what we do upstream, instead of having this all downstream like we've been doing for years. Without further ado, dive into what Minidump is all about. You can read this, but it's basically the problem statement of PSTORM. You have dump devices with 16 gigs of RAM. We don't want to send 16 gigs of RAM across the network. It's too much information. There is potentially secret information that users don't want to share. So we want to collect less memory and send that for crash mount analysis. When you move it up. So what Minidump tries to do is it's a firmware-based solution. We want to register what we want to dump with firmware, and when firmware detects there's a crash, normally you would do a system RAM dump. Instead, you collect just whatever regions you've registered from the kernel or from whatever other subsystem that might be running on your SoC. I think the previous talk was a little bit more x86 focused. We're more ARM focused, so there's other subsystems that co-processors that we care about. Minidump is there for mostly for devices deployed to an end user. You can't collect a full RAM dump. Crashes could be due to hardware bugs, software bugs. We don't always get kernel panics. Before the presentation, I took a quick look at the past year of all the RAM dumps that Qualcomm has gotten internally. Only 70% of them are from kernel panics. And of those 70%, a lot of them are just watchdog bytes. So what Qualcomm does is when there's a watchdog byte, we panic the kernel. I think other devices will typically try and let that go to firmware and actually crash the device directly. The amount of useful information that you can get out of a limited RAM dump. I'm trying to remember what this talk is supposed to be about. The amount of useful information that we can collect from a RAM dump is limited if you send less information. So we're trying to register as much information as we can. So there's a few different options, existing solutions. There's KDump. This slide is going to look very similar to the previous deck. So it's nice. You can use any user space to collect the RAM dump and do what you want to do, send it. There's some problems with it. There's a lot of memory overhead. You need two kernel boots to come back to normal operation. You've got to boot the KEXEC kernel, then you've got to boot your normal kernel. And only the kernel can trigger KDump. So if you have something that's not a panic, like a knock error, you're in trouble. PSTORM works really well. It's got pretty low overhead. There's no extra kernel boots. You just reboot, and you have this persistent region of memory that you can look at. There's some issues with it that we've kind of observed. There's some collection time overhead, right? You have another console device that copies all those messages from dmessage into the RAM leak region. We want to try and optimize that. We don't have to do it. Why should we do it? Like I said, you need a memory reservation for the RAM region. We don't have to create a memory reservation. We'd like not to. And it's also limited to memory that the kernel can reliably copy before the crash. So in case of kernel panic, you may not have all the ADSP and various messages from the kernel. So like if you have things in panic notifier path, you can't necessarily get all that information. Minidump is there to try and minimize the memory overhead to capture a small dump by sort of shoving it to firmware. It maintains a table of physical addresses and sizes. You don't need to copy the message buffers or face buffers or anything like that. And so that reduces collection time overhead. The firmware will collect the region directly to storage. I don't know if anyone here is familiar with RAM dump collection on an SoC, but usually the firmware will collect the RAM dump for you, and then you'll get a reboot back to the device. And then, so in our implementation of Minidump, we have a table of contents, and every table of contents has a list of regions that you want to try and collect. So it's just a two-stage lookup. We have each entry usually corresponds to a particular subsystem. And then in that subsystem, like would be one for Linux, you can have a list of regions that Linux cares about. For instance, if you want to collect log buff buffers, there's multiple buffers, of course, or ftrace buffers, you would register those physical addresses with the framework. And on our Qualcomm devices, on our implementation, when you get the Minidump crash, the device will reboot and collect an ELF and ELF and copy that to whatever storage device is available on the chip. So this is a little bit more of the same information. It's that same struct in C code format. So Minidump, some of our older firmware implementations have a limit on how many regions that can be registered. So if we try and register, like for instance, every task struct, that's a lot of copying that needs to happen. The number of regions that could be registered. And we're trying to open it up so that way anybody can register a Minidump region. So if, for instance, some new subsystem comes along that we're interested in registering, they can just make a generic call to register their buffers that they want to dump. So Mukesh has been doing all the work for Minidump. He sent V5 the patches. How long ago, Mukesh, was it? A few weeks ago? It was a few weeks ago. You're on mute, by the way.
Almost 1.5 months back.
Yeah, a few weeks ago. And for now, we're trying to just collect existing PSTOR records. We don't want to try and do anything too controversial. PSTOR already collects it in a pretty convenient format, so we're just registering PSTOR for now. We've already upstreamed support for Minidump on remote processors, so things like ADSP, CDSP, and MODEM are already supported. And those drivers maintain a list of segments that they want to dump during recovery. A core dump framework is used when the ADSP or CDSP crashes. You can collect the core dump from those subsystems. The Minidump framework also, like when the firmware and the whole device crashes, those regions are also collected. So it's kind of like a subset. So here's some of the additional information that we thought would be useful to collect. So it's kind of our answer to PSTOR, what we want to extract from PSTOR. One thing that's been helpful for us is initial BFD message logs. So if you want to make sure the device came up successfully, sometimes there's hints in the initial 100 seconds of demessage. We sometimes like to know if there's IRQ statistics. So if you're getting a bunch of interrupts, that tends to be a hint that maybe a device is misbehaving. There's run queue information. Guess you want to take the information here?
Yeah, there are a bunch of information we currently in the downstream use. So we are at this moment we are looking for these type of information to be captured in the PSTOR exactly. So currently like MMI tracing, IRQ state, which will help in the IRQ storm kind of use cases, timer summary, which actually the last presentation is talk about already, it does it, but it does it after panic notifier. It print into the D message itself. So those, some of the stuffs are already there, but somehow it is not available as the last presentation went, right? So run queue information, what was the run queue, all CPU were running, and then jump stack of each kind of crash, each core in a kind of crash. So exactly these kind of information we are looking at, and some of them, the basic information we are trying to hook with the already existing PSTOR. So all the front end, the PSTOR already captures its type ftrace d message and console message. We are trying to register with the Minidump. And so that this is the basic aim of the Minidump infra to be, and at least the Linux infra we are trying to develop to capture these four front end. And later we are trying to improve maybe pstore to capture some of the stuff which is not available. Or this is our aim is going to be, and which is similar to what exactly we discussed in the last. And here and there we are going to improve. And yeah, Minidump is something which is basically not only for kernel crashes, it also covers non-kernel crashes. So basically there are use cases where whenever the system itself, the kernel in itself is not able to run, it is get stuck in somewhere, some transaction is stuck in CPU stuck, and it is not able to run any instruction. In that case, that is where the pstore will not, I mean, kernel will not able to run and suddenly it will crash, right? So Minidump will help in those, even on those situations, it will try to correct random. And whatever the information it captures, whatever the register region at that moment, it will be coming as an ELF. So entire Linux will be registered as an one ELF, and all the other subsystem, right? Like in the last slide, we discussed about the remote processor also. All are different indexes it use in a global table. So table of content, and finally each subsystem, CDSP, modem, and apps, APSS, we call it as a Linux only. So it will capture one entry in that, and finally all the dump entry, registered entry will be dumped at the type panic. The only overhead it does not have is it does not need extra memory. So because of the, in the upstream engagement in the various version, we got to know that hooking with the pstore looks it looks very similar, but it has much more capability than that. Given the physical address and the size, it can capture, it can dump anything. So yeah, this is what we are looking for.
Yeah, thanks Mukesh. So I guess, yeah, what I wanted to sort of get feedback from the community is, we want to try and expand how useful Minidump is for other folks. I think pstore works well. It's a kind of middleweight option. It's lighter than kdump. We think Minidump is even lighter than what pstore can offer. And so we're kind of thinking about other SOC vendors that are interested in this. Do we think it's interesting for virtual machines? You know, we're kind of trying to see what interest there is taking Minidump outside Qualcomm. Do we think it's useful? Yeah, kind of 15 minutes for discussion.
Oh, I guess I have them both. Yeah. Well, if anyone wants that, toss them.
I don't want to ask those questions. I want to have other ones.
Oh, okay. I have my own questions as well, so we're potentially going outside of the intended discussion. But I guess I just wanted to say that this is really interesting, because it sounds like the way I understand from your explanation is that you're essentially letting clients, you know, around, or you want to let clients in the kernel register, these are my interesting bits of data to be dumped for firmware, and then the firmware will later on dump it, which is a really interesting way to instead of filtering after the fact, to declare it ahead of time. And you also mentioned some user space stuff. Can user space do that same thing, or is that a kernel only functionality to register information to get dumped?
Do you mind if I take that? So actually the user space thing he discussed, right? It was for remote processors. So is already there. So remote processor recovery path will dev core dump path, it will send you a bit. That is the different path altogether. Whether in that case modem will go through a recovery phase after crash, right? So in that case, in the core dump get collected, but the system is still running in that case. But Minidump is not; it's only for kernel crashes. Kernel and plus the non-kernel crashes also it covers. Firmware, hypervisor, everyone can register. So
gotcha. I think, for instance, our initial D message, we have that implemented as a downstream feature where we have a sort of K thread that runs for 100 seconds, or I think it's a timer that runs for 100 seconds, and it collects the first 100 seconds of the message. I think that would not be acceptable very upstream.
I want that. I've wanted that sometimes, you know?
That's interesting to have it in the kernel. So we implemented it in the kernel because we we weren't sure if user space would come up, and if user space doesn't come up,
yeah,
then you want to have it coming from the kernel as best you can.
Yes.
We could probably implement that as a user space feature where you can just say, hey, go, here's a file in Minidump, and you can put whatever you want to go into it.
That's super nice, because servers definitely have a lot of memory that they might waste on a, or not waste, but use on a print K log. But even then, sometimes high uptime, it's like it's been a 2-3 years since we booted up. It'd be nice to have some of that information.
Yeah.
Anyhow.
Were there other questions? Because I was going to ask something else to answer. No. All right. Well, I'll just ask my question then. Two things that I want to ask about. One of them was you guys are talking about non-kernel crashes. And that was one part of it. And the second question is you're saying that DevP store is a higher overhead than Minidump. And I'm not understanding it. Can you elaborate why you considered PStore sort of too high of an overhead? Because to me, it feels like it's just one memory region that's set aside, right? It's not like it's thousands of things you have to process.
Yeah, so I mean, if you don't have to set aside a memory region, that'd be nice if we don't have to, right? It's 100 megabytes that you can reclaim and give to users to run
an app. So Chromos only sets aside 1 megabyte for Dev PStore, and that's reserved RAM. That's on all Chromos devices. So that's not a very high overhead. And then we have gigabytes of RAM in the system.
Well, so, I mean, I don't know how big is Logbuff usually?
Yeah, megabyte. Oh. The Logbuff usually less than a megabyte.
We usually, how big is it, 4 megabytes?
512 KB, almost one.
Yeah, but I mean, my argument still holds. 4 megabytes on an 8 gigabyte system is irrelevant, basically.
Yeah, I mean, I will tell you exactly the overhead. I'll try to explain. So overhead, at least we cannot tell this RAM backend is taking this much memory. It is up to the user how much you want to give it. But yeah, let's say example, we talk about P message, right? User space logs. For the each message, it will be P message writing to the backend. So you are always doing mem copy of stuffs, right? In the background.
Right, but I'm looking at the laundry list of things that you guys are collecting in Minidump. Right, IRQ information, MMIO tracing. I mean, there's a lot more stuff there than just one blob of memory.
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I mean, the advantage here is if you don't have to copy format.
All right.
I know it's not a lot, but.
Okay, it's fine. I just want to understand the perception, right? It was just for me, the perception was on. The other one was non-kernel crash sources. Can you elaborate on what a non-kernel crash is? What you guys are referring to there? I think you mentioned Watchdog was one of them. There's a hardware Watchdog. Is that a non-kernel crash? Are there other sources of non-kernel crashes?
Yeah.
So I'll go. Yeah, so non-kernel crashes could be anything. Let's say some XPU fault, secure register accessing can result in XPU fault. And those kind of, it will result in a non-secure byte. I mean, kernel will not even get a chance to run in that cases. So MMIO tracing, what accesses resulted in that crash can help in the debugging that, okay, this register read write can cause that XPU fault. Other kind of crashes could be, there are other kind of crashes could be the bark. For us, exactly, internally, we manage a non-secure bark is fatal for us. Let's say if any core is not able to run for a certain duration, it will result in a byte, and that cause a RAM dump to happen. So in that case, it can be anything. I mean, core got hung during that, core got stuck during the TLB flush or something. It can be any issue which can be resulting into, and we have a mechanism in place. Let's say in certain scenario, this will always result in a byte, and kernel will, because kernel, it's a transition itself, it got stuck and it has to result in a byte. So yeah, those are non-kernel crashes I was talking about.
Okay, so the kernel could be the root cause of those crashes, but you still, because the kernel itself is not causing its own panic function directly, it's an indirect hardware triggering the crash, like a watchdog timer I'm familiar with this. I'm asking because on servers that I worked on in the past had the thing called a high priority machine check. So if you were to try to access, for example, an MMIO region, a physical address that was not mapped, it would crash, the chipset would cause a crash that was caused by the kernel, but it wasn't really It was not triggered by any kernel piece of software. It was the hardware externally triggering this crash. So that's why I'm trying to understand your definition. That's all. Thank you.
Yeah, it's
similar. We have a question from Guillerme up on the online.
Yeah. Thanks, Stephen. So I found the Minidump very interesting idea. I have a question about the firmware side of it. You mentioned it can write to some, for example, to an SD card. So does it require to have an MMC driver to access the card, or what if the SD card is formatted like ext4, or this case is not supported? I mean, you need a raw SD card exclusive for that.
So basically, currently we support wherever all the images, right? The binaries of the other non-HLS and I mean non-firmware as well as the Linux binaries are flashed. Whereas we those as a storage reason. And one of the partition, we can reserve it for this Minidump collection, we can call it. And firmware has access to read and write to these partitions. And based on the, so it does not only write a Linux region, it also write the some firmware region which it wants to dump. So some, let's say, firmware bootloader logs also it dumps. So yeah, it can be MMC, and based on the configuration wise, we can set it, right? Yeah. Is that answering your question? Yes, you're saying MMC is flashed? No, it's a partition should be reserved for those, exactly.
Okay,
otherwise,
okay,
it can result, it will not able to write, and it may not collect. Maybe if a brick device can be brick in that case. But yeah, it's a pre-known partition where it will be.
There's a dedicated partition that firmware knows to write to. Qualcomm firmware is just hard coded to write to that partition. So that's how it works. Does that answer your question?
I think the room might have been disconnected.
Sure. Thank you.
Okay, I think you got it. Yeah.
I disconnected for some time, I guess.
You can. In the interest of not proliferating ELF core dumps that look like ELF core dumps but aren't the same as regular core dumps.
Yeah.
We've dealt with this a lot. Do you include the VM core info note?
I don't think we do. Would be something we'd be interested to add.
Yeah. So it's just a physical address that you could register, except you would have to it wouldn't be a regular ELF segment. It would be a PT note segment with a little bit of extra metadata. And that'd make it easier to use like pre-existing tools with it.
I see.
But you probably need to tell the firmware like this needs different metadata.
We'll have to, yeah. Let me talk to you about that offline so I can figure out what we need to tell our
firmware. I mean, you guys probably have your own tooling that doesn't care, but if you want to use like other tooling, it might expect it.
Well, we'd like to use tooling that's more available because we don't like maintaining these things either. Go ahead, Doug.
How rigid is the firmware with respect to the kernel version, right? So I think is it just getting the regions of memory and storing them? So it's the kernel is in charge of essentially describing like what regions of memory it would need to save for dmessage.
Yes.
And there's no like hard coding of the dmessage structure in the firmware or anything?
No. So, okay. Yeah, so you have to know which kernel or which kernel version that dump came from to know like the structure. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, essentially.
Yeah,
so
you
the...
have to be able to map the kernel version to the dump.
We are also trying to capture the Linux banner exactly in the ELF. So as a part of ELF, right? Which crash belongs to which kernel version. So that is the patch set. If you go through it, one of the patch is also trying to capture in Linux banner as well. And also the one thing exactly in the last talk we discussed about the reserve memory of pstore, right? That also we are covering in the patch series. In the last talk, Giram was talking about, right? There is no kernel parameter exist exactly to reserve RAM ops region. So yeah, that was also kept, the series was captured, yeah.
Yeah, Hari had a question. If the primary motive with Minidump is to avoid having to reserve memory, that is needed for a full Kdump? Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
That and to be able to get dumps that aren't triggered by kernel panic.
Also, I guess the mini dumps probably allow not having warm reset. I know when we did Qualcomm Chromebooks, we had to specifically jump through hoops to get Qualcomm to let us do a warm reset. They had to make up what they called mission mode warm reset, because in their mind, rebooting and preserving RAM was not something that you did. And so on all other SoCs, it generally works okay, but Qualcomm seemed to have a policy about really, really cold rebooting on every reboot. And that kind of broke PStore. And so I would imagine that writing to something like eMMC would also work around that requirement.
I had a question about, you mentioned that you're capturing the stack, the stacks of hung tasks, basically. So is that something that you like? You patch the kernel or register a hook or something on a hung task? You register the physical memory region of the test struct, or how are you doing that?
I think for the
Hung tasks, we don't collect. Actually, these the slides which were mentioning what we are looking at exactly, those information for debugging information, at least the minimal information we are looking at to be captured for a debugging an issue. Not 100%, but it's somewhat some extent.
Sorry, yeah, so you're saying that's something you want, but don't have implemented yet?
Yes, yes. We have a hooks in place somehow that, I mean, we were not capturing exactly the your hung task thing. Hung task is not mentioned here, but we were talking about, right, that there is a parameter exists if you write W to CSRQ trigger, right, that will flood that message. We could have an idea about we can reserve one region where take some extra buffer where it, and we will reserve that memory with the mini dump, and we'll redirect that entire buffer, entire text content of the to that buffer. So, and because it is registered with the minidump, it will automatically capture.
Thanks.
So instead of flooding the D message, we can have a separate buffer and register with this. So, but exactly, this is a downstream thing, right? We are looking something which is we can upstream and maybe add it in a PStore if possible.
All right. I think this has been some really excellent discussion. Thank you for this presentation. It's really cool to have these contrasting approaches and having everyone in the room to talk about it. So thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.